Now, today, as you have noticed, we have picked up on a topic of the changing face of marriage. Marriage, we have discussed so many times, and most of you have had different types of experiences, good, bad, whatever it is. You have all had, right? In fact, what happens with us is right from our childhood, we get exposed to the interaction between our father and mother. And that gives us some idea about what is marriage. Although, frankly speaking, we don't get a correct idea. We get a very different type of idea. Anyway, for whatever it's worth, we have this thing, and then we have this very, very idealistic notion about marriage. And we think that when I grow up and when I get married, my marriage is going to be absolutely perfect and stuff like that. So that's how the whole thing goes. Then the actual experiences of marriage, then children, all these things happen. Anyway, what I was trying to highlight by this today's session is to make ourselves aware of how the concept is, you know, changing from time to time. In India, for example, we had a time when marriage used to mean an entire village getting married. So this huge barat used to go from one village to another, pick up the bride and bring her back to a joint family where everybody used to welcome her, and she used to become part of that family. So she not only had her husband, she had her grandparents-in-law, parents-in-law, uncles-in-law, aunts-in-law, cousins-in-law, all those things. That is how it used to be for a very, very long time. And in some rural areas, it still does happen. The other day, one of our colleagues was telling me, Vinita, she's here already. Vinita was describing how, when she got married into a traditional North Indian family near beyond Delhi, and how, the daughter-in-law was supposed to behave in the in-law's house and all that. So within this generation, we have seen so many changes, so many things, happening. Now, when we actually talk about some of the changes and stuff like that has happened, or rather is happening, we think that most of the modern concepts of marriage or revolutionary concepts have started coming in from the West, but actually that is not true. In our traditional systems, though not very frequently, we have been exposed to this concept of somebody, ritually getting married to a tree or to a donkey or something like that. And that was the superstition that if this person is married off to this person, such tree or the donkey or whatever it is, then if there is some evil spirit, that will get taken off or something like that. I don't know the details of it, but we used to keep hearing this quite often, much before all the modern concepts of marriage and all that came in. Then, of course, the one significant change that started coming in our Indian families is this concept of the love marriage versus the arranged marriage. A couple of generations back, it was almost always arranged marriages. Today, I don't have statistics, but definitely one is observing and seeing that there are more and more of what we call as love marriage, meaning to say that it is the bride and the groom, the boy and the girl, who select each other. They don't leave it to the parents. There are things in between also. There are, selection of a boy and girl by the elders, and then they meet and then they fall in love with each other. There are also this concept of you like a boy or you like a girl, and then, after you got to know and you are feeling very attracted, then you go to your parents and the parents say, okay, we will arrange everything. Yeah? So that's how concept goes. Of course, there is this big battle going on, which has got a lot of connotations on it. Should single sex marriage be allowed? That is, man marrying a man and woman marrying a woman. Few years back, the concept of homosexuality as a crime was reduced, but the laws didn't go to the extent of allowing people to get married. There are very few countries increasing in number lately who do allow people of the same sex to get married. Well, the way I see it, it is inevitable. Sometime or the other, it is going to happen in India also. But as of now, it is not legally permitted. But that does not mean that people don't live together, same-sex couples. And I know at least a few same-sex couples who have been very committed, almost what we call, you know, traditionally we say life partner. No, I do know of people. The other day there was this counselor of mine who invited me for the silver jubilee of his, I can't call it marriage, but they're living together, or their relationship. So there are these two men who have completed 25 years of living together. And not only are they a happy couple, they also fight the same way as man-woman couples would fight. They sulk their days and they don't talk to each other, and then they get back into each other's arms, and then they reaffirm their love for each other. That's the way things are going. These are the changes which are coming in. Then, of course, what has started and is growing in metropolitan cities is this concept of live-in relationship, meaning to say that we do not want to get married. Otherwise, we are like a married couple, in the sense that, you know, you have romance, you have sex, you're sharing the same house, and you're sharing the finances, and you're sharing everything else, but you do not have that piece of paper or that, you know, religious ritual which says that you two are married. Comparatively in India, it's a recent phenomenon. Yes, I did know of live-in couples even 20, 30 years back, but they were far and few. Today, the numbers are increasing. So what will be the outcome of such people? We will get to know only after a generation passes by, and we'll be able to review, you know, what sort of life do single-sex unmarried couples, but live-in, not single-sex, sorry, unmarried couples who are having a live-in relationship. How strong is their commitment? And in the long run, how does their relationship last? All that is going on. The other thing is that of children. Slowly, it is increasing in India where people do want to get married, but they do not want to have children. That was unheard of one generation back. In fact, if there was a couple who got married and if the wife did not produce a child in 1, 2, 3 years, everybody would be at their back and saying, what is wrong? Why is it happening? As though, you know, there's something wrong, that's why they are not having children. Today, it is reasonably, I would say, an accepted form that, yes, we are married. We are happily married. We want to continue to be married for the rest of our lives, but we do not want to have children. This concept in the West was, has been there for quite some time. And there they talk about dink families, sink families, disc families, and cisc families. Now, cisc families is single income, some kids. Sink families is single income, no kids. Then we have disc families, double income, some kids. And dink families, double income, no kids. So as the education of girls and the, you know, promotion of the self-esteem and identity of girls is increasing even in India, there are those people who are choosing not to get married. Some of them are choosing to postpone having children. So they do get married, but the girl says that if at this time I get pregnant, it's going to affect my career graph. I'm upwardly mobile, I'm putting in so much effort, I'm so well qualified and I have this expertise, I don't want to give that up just because I have a kid. That again is the first generation. We have to see what happens if either a couple decides not to have children, or they decide that we will postpone children and have maybe 10 years after we married or whatever it is. What would be the long-term consequences of such marriages? All these things we have to see. The career of the woman today, there are a lot of young women who are very, very career conscious, and they don't want to affect. We have this long distance relationships, quite a few of them, where they are married or they are in a relationship, but they're not living together. They're living maybe in different countries, because one finds employment or higher studies or something, you know, in a different continent, and the other one doesn't want to go. So they continue to be committed to each other, but they are not living under the same roof, not for just days or months, but even for, you know, years. The main thing is that the gender difference, though it has to a great extent narrowed down, it has not completely gone away. There is still this thing of, you know, the male domination. To give you a simple example, I've had occasions even recently and earlier also where, let's say a girl is unmarried, she was pursuing her career or whatever, maybe the reason, or parents were unwell or something like that, and the girl has, let's say, crossed 30 years of age. Now, when she starts looking for a suitable partner, the marriage market is so skewed in favor of the man. You will have 60-year-old men getting 30-year-old, you know, brides, but you will not have a 30-year-old bride getting a good, you know, groom of her age group. That still exists today, except of course when she has the ability to move around, socialize, find the right guy, and then it becomes much easier. So these are some of the things that have been, you know, happening. Now, another concept, though not very, very frequent, but which I have seen happening, is what they refer to as open marriage, meaning to say that they are legally married, they're living under the same roof, they may be having kids also, but it is not a monogamous marriage. They decide that I want to have another partner or partners. Both of them say this is an open marriage. You do what you want, I do what I want. I'm going to have partners, or I'm going to have other romantic liaisons, but as long as we do it respectively, not making a scandal in society. And at the end of the day, we are back home as family, and we continue to live as husband and wife. That's another thing which is, you know, happening. And this is also increasing because of the mobility of people. Like I told you, if somebody is married but is living very far away for long distances, there also this concept is, you know, coming in. So many areas, so many times, all these things are happening. One more factor which I have been observing is that some people have decided not to get married till a very late age. One was, I told you, marry but not have children for late age. The other is, I don't want to get married. I'm not against the concept of marriage. I do want to have a life partner, but not at this age. I'd like to spend some more time, you know, pursuing my career, being independent, maybe earning and saving money, and then only I'll go in for a you know, marriage. The other thing, of course, that has happened is the, you know, concept or the idea of separation and divorces. Divorce rate in India is steadily increasing. But what is very strange is that more than divorce, separation is increasing. And separation is not recorded anywhere. I know of couples who have sort of given up on each other, but they continue to live under the same roof like strangers, out of convenience. I also know people who, when they are no longer connected to their partner, but do not want to go in for a legal separate divorce or whatever it is. So one person takes up a job or something in another city, and the excuse given is that I'm not living with my partner because I got this job opportunity and I'm there and the partner is here. But that's not true. The has consciously decided to be away, because they don't want to live together. And that's one of the things, like, unlike in the Western countries, you know, where if they don't get along, they just file for divorce and within a short time they get it. Here, as you're all aware, the concept of divorce is a very, very cumbersome process. And that is making a lot of people not go through the legal process of divorce. Okay, just to, you know, take you into a little different type of thing. We had come across some time back of a gentleman who had married not a woman, not a man, but a hologram. This had created a lot of flutter in the media. After that, I don't hear much about it, but I feel it is happening. Now, what is a hologram? Let's have a look. Anis will show this to you. Here you are, Akihiko Kondo, a 38-year-old man, married a computerized hologram called Miku. Life with Miku, according to him, has advantages over being with a human partner. So Akihiko says, she's always there for me. She'll never betray me. And I'll never have to see her get ill or die. Think about it. People are doing it. I have no idea how happy or fulfilled they are, but these are some of the indicators of how the concept of marriage is going to change in the coming years. So as long as we are open to the idea that the whole institution or concept of marriage is changing, and we have to accept it. We cannot expect our marriage to be the way the marriage of our parents or grandparents was. So how do we go about it? I prepared a few very simple points. If you can, you know, think about it. This is just food for thought. I'm not imposing anything on you, but here is some food for thought for you to think about what is the future of marriage, particularly in context of the Indian culture or the Indian scenario. A few points if you'd like to mull over it. One is, plan for at least 60 years. People do not understand that if you are really going to have what we call as a life partner, on an average, you are going to live 60 years with that person. So people are so short-sighted, people who think only of what is the issue or what is happening now, they are the ones who have difficulty. Now, my mother-in-law keeps coming and she creates problems. That's why I'm not getting along with my spouse. Mother-in-law is not going to be there for a very long time. Even if she's alive, she'll become very old and she'll mellow down and stuff like that. So when you look at marriage, whether you are going to marry or whether you're already married, just visualize in a holistic sense what is going to be the concept or idea of marriage for an average period of 60 years. Sometimes it can even be more. The other thing which I've always been emphasizing upon is that you build relationships after the marriage. Whatever happens before, I come across couples who've been in a relationship for 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, 8 years, and then they got married, thinking, now I know my partner so well, but it doesn't work. If you want a marriage to be harmonious, the relationship building has to start after the marriage, after you start living together and you are legally wedded as husband and wife. What you do at that stage, the developmental phase of the marriage, as I always say, that is the crucial part which will determine how happy, how harmonious your marriage is going to be. So this is what I said, you plan for 60 years, at least try to visualize 10 years from now, 30 years from now, what is going to be the scenario? What do we need to prepare for? What are the pluses and minuses? And how am I going to cope with the situation? When you have children, how are you going to cope with it? When the children grow up and fly out of the nest, how is life going to be? When you enter into your sunset years, how is life going to be? These are the things that we need to look into. And then I, you know, always enjoy expressing this point that there are four categories of people. There are men, there are women, there are husbands, and there are wives. And that is something which is very, very fascinating. Every now and then I come across a case where a person behaves completely differently with, let's say, all the women in his life, be it a mother or sister or sister-in-law or daughter or niece or whoever. And the person behaves completely differently with his partner. His or her, I'm talking from both genders. So what I am as a man and what I am as a husband are two completely different things. One cannot judge a person based on what this person is with other people. One has to judge based on what this person is with the person who is what we refer to as a life partner, romantic partner, or married spouse, or whatever it is. That has to be kept in mind. Now, we understand that there is a craving to be special in somebody's life. This is something which is so, so rampant. I want to feel special in somebody's life. I want to be the most important person in somebody's life. I want exclusive love, which I'm not willing to share with somebody. Now, this comes into the forefront when it comes to the marital relationship. And this is what starts creating problems. When a person gets married, please understand that the person is not giving up on all other relationships. Yes, marriage may be a very, very important relationship once a person is married, but it is not an exclusive relationship. You can be special, but then somebody else may be special in their own way. A girl may think that her husband is very special, but she may think that her father is also very special in a different way. She's not going to give up her special relationship with her father just because she has a spouse. No. But can we understand that marriage is not something which is exclusive, which, you know, doesn't come into play with others? And the last point in this, as you can see, is that let us now treat marriage as a contract. We have so many contracts in life, and we understand that we need to build up on that and work on that thing. But what happens is that whether you do a court marriage, a registered marriage, or a marriage in a temple. See, as a writer said long back, Indians are so caught up with the concept of wedding that they don't give importance to marriage. Wedding is a one-time event. It is over and done with. But marriage is lifelong. So, do you understand? Like if you were to, let's say, start a business, and you find a very compatible person and you say, come, let's be partners and start this business and run this business together. There are so many things that you have to understand. What are my strengths? What are my partner's strengths? What can that person bring into this partnership? What do I bring into this partnership? What happens if there are doubts and things are not going well? We work on all these things, isn't it? I feel in today's world, we cannot just hide behind saying marriages are made in heaven, marriage is divine, marriage is sacrosanct. No, we can't do that. We have to understand that marriage is a contract between two human beings, generally a man and a woman. And when you are entering into a contract, it is not whom you choose to be a partner, but how do you lay down certain ground rules. That is what I always call as the developmental phase of the marriage. And based on that, how do I go about building up and strengthening? Inevitably, there is no such thing as perfect or ideal marriage. There is no such thing as Mr. Right and Miss Right. But a lot can be done if you take up the attitude that I have. Let's say I'll give you another simple example. You save up money for a long time and you buy a house. You look at 20 houses and you find this is the most suitable one, then you go ahead and buy that house. Now, do you think that house will be perfect, immaculate, everything right? No. You say, this side the rain comes in from the window. Or when I keep this door open, there's a lot of dust coming in. Or the temperature is a little higher because this room faces the west. Or the water supply is not very good. You know, I have to store water. But you don't give up on that, no? What you do is to try to keep on improving, that I made a commitment. I have purchased this house. So now I'm going to keep working on it to make it more and more suitable and more pleasurable for me. And as you keep doing that, you will find that the house becomes more and more comfortable and compatible for you. And you can then, you know, live in that house for the rest of your life. Treat marriage as the same way. That I have entered into this contract. Things will not be perfect, but there is enough and more scope to keep improving it. Please keep this thought in mind while I take my 1 minute break, and Sonal is here to say hi to you.
Good afternoon. I can see new names, excitement to know what are the different changes face of marriage, excitement to listen from Ali, what he has to speak. Lovely. Along with all those excitements, I will be just updating you that what's happening at Banjara. Yeah. Before that, I will just tell you that anybody who has anything to share or question, start posting it. So once the break gets over, Ali will come back and he will start addressing those comments. Good afternoon, Vinita. Yeah. So what's happening in Banjara is, last Saturday we had workshop on counseling skills, which went really well. Response was very good. Feedback was also very good. You would have seen I had gone live for 10 minutes or so. Just to give you an update of what was happening, if you had seen Banjara's page about last week. And afternoon, we had our inauguration of the new batch, DCS 25. It was so much fun to know that there are so many who are willing to join to help people understand counseling skills, understand themselves. For different purpose, everybody has made a choice to join DCS. And if you think, because as you know, the first week goes a little slow, if you think that, you know, there are somebody who is willing to or wanting to, or you think that will benefit from doing DCS, please send them as soon as possible, because I think in next 2 to 3 weeks admissions will close completely. Every year this has been what you call an experience where, you know, once we close the admissions, then they'll say, please allow one, you know, this one very close to me, he wants to join, she wants to join, to avoid all that last minute rush. Please send them as soon as possible, even if they don't want to, but they want to know that what is DCS all about. Send them. Anis will happily explain them everything which he's been doing to all of the inquiries that come, all the phone calls, all the mails, everything she attends beautifully. So if you have someone whom you think should know about DCSL, then let them take that decision. Give them, connect them to Anis. You all know Anis very well by now, I think. Yes, the smiling face every time. Yeah. So that's what happening in Banjara. We had two classes of the two teams, means the class one. And it's so nice to see they all coming and, you know, experiences, the classroom experience, like getting that notebook, getting that pen, listening to all the do's and don'ts and what all they should be expecting in this 1 year. And you know, what is the takeaway, what people are surprised of mainly is no theory, no exam. That's the biggest relief. Then the next question will be, but then how will you evaluate us? How will we know that we are progressing? Whoever has done DCS definitely knows that there are ways and means that we assess through QR, the quick reviews, then the skill sharpening classes, and then the VIVAs we call it as. But they are all so simple that, you know, it simplifies the whole funda of what counseling is, and the learning becomes more important. Rather than going from, you know, giving 1 mark, 2 mark, 5 marks for this, nothing of that sort. Beautiful learning. Whoever has done DCS knows it. So whoever you think can benefit, please send them ASAP. Back to Ali.
Yes, I'm back. Okay, so let us see what are the comments, suggestions, and questions from your end. We start with Veena, who says, but if it is one-sided, how to cope the adjustments? See, here is where I come back to what I've told you, that there are men, women, husbands, and wives. You can have one-sided thing in other relationships. What do? You have an elderly father who is very, very cranky, who doesn't understand. You keep loving him, you keep taking care of him, but he doesn't respond. You don't say, I'm going to divorce you and I'm going to walk off and I'll have nothing to do with you. You learn how to tolerate. You learn what all you can accept. You try different ways. Maybe you try and tell your mother or your sister or somebody that, you know, please try to tell him that he's being unreasonable. And we move on with the relationship because you say, all said and done, this is my father. It can happen with an adolescent child, for example. The child just is not responding to you. As a small child, he used to be so loving, caring. Now he has come to teenage and he has become very rebellious. And anything that you say, he's going against the thing. He's not willing to listen to you. He's not willing for any compromises. You don't give up on him and say that from tomorrow, you're not my child. I have nothing to do with you. We do work on that, isn't it? That is what I'm trying to say. That even in an extreme case where it is one-sided, to what extent can I improve on it? To what extent can I put in my efforts? And here comes a very important thing. That I should not put all my eggs in one basket. See, if my father is cranky, I share my love with my mother or my aunt or my sister. And that is how, you know, I can tolerate the bad behavior of my father. Same thing with a child, same thing with a sibling or a friend. If we take up that attitude, that if I have committed myself for life to a partner and things are not moving in the sense that the partner is not reciprocating, I'm the one who's putting in all my efforts. Start making efforts to build up other good, healthy relationships. And you will find to some extent this person realizes that you are not dependent on him or her and starts making some efforts. Even if the person doesn't make efforts, you are still happy because you have other, you know, happy and harmonious relationships going on. Okay. Tessin says, what can we keep co-parenting smooth? Yes, this is another important area, because marriage inevitably in most cases results in children. So now the child has two parents. See, try and look at it, the children who are unfortunate not to have two parents, the task of the single parent is really, really tough. It becomes very, very difficult. So now if there are two parents, there are bound to be differences. If you have two employees or two colleagues or two customers in your workplace, they will not always agree with each other. So you do look for a middle path. Don't have unrealistic expectations. Somewhere learn to let go. So when we talk about parenting, remember parenting is a very, very transitory thing. We spoke about marriage being for 60, 70 years. Parenting is what? For maximum 20 years. By the time the child becomes an adult, the child is out of your nest. So even if your partner is not cooperating with you on the type of parenting, go along with it for the time being. Make your efforts to make him or her change. But if that is not happening, move on and see how things go. Tessin also says, yeah, Tessin, we have already answered, no? Co-parenting. How do you make it smooth? Vinita says, earlier at least we grew up with the thought that no matter how much we wanted to study or work, ultimately our goal will be to get married. I feel now that concept is changed. Yes, exactly. Changed, or at least it is changing. So we have to move with the time, no? We have to understand that change is inevitable in every aspect of our life. We can't do anything to bring about, you know, to turn the clock back. I remember childhood, I had a friend who used to live in a nice palatial bungalow, dilapidated, old, but on a couple of acres of land with a mango orchard and this and that. And in those good old days, he used to be very critical about apartments. What are these people doing? How can you live in an apartment? Anyway, I lost touch. This was in a different city. And the other day he was visiting. And when I asked him, you know, how is life, what's happening? And he said that I have moved in with my son. He's retired now. So he said, I have moved in with my son and I am living in such and such place, apartment complex. I said, you living in an apartment? And he said, yes, I'm on the 13th floor, 2 BHK, 13th floor, 1,000 square feet. I said, I can't believe that you are doing that. You know, he quoted a very sweet proverb, which I used to hear in my childhood. Nai mamu se nakta mamu acha. Rather than not having an uncle, you may as well have an uncle who is incomplete. At least you have an uncle. So that was his concept. He said, I am retired. I can't afford to do things by myself. At least I am lucky that I have a son and daughter-in-law who take care of me. So I have to make that compromise. And I live in that little apartment, which I had never done. I have accepted it. These are the simple formulae by which you can make your life more comfortable. Each one of us can do it. Right. Okay, Sabiha says, congratulations, Ali, 25th batch. I am from the second batch. Yes, Sabiha, I remember you. And you are the people who laid the foundation for, you know, the DCS course. We learned so much from you. And today, yes, we have completed our 25th and we have started our 26th batch. Surekha says, earlier, marriage was 100-100. Now it is 50-50. It wasn't about dividing everything in half. It was about giving everything you had. But now the reverse is the accepted norm. Yes, but as I have been saying, it is part of life. You have to accept it the same way as my friend accepted that from living in a house which had 2 acres of land and orchards, now he is living in a 1,000 square feet 2-bedroom apartment. But there are other positive sides to it. Later on, he kept telling me how there are so many facilities. He says, now how I meet so many people, I just have to go down and there's a nice little place to sit and I have so many people of my age group with whom I can chat up. I don't have to get out and go to somebody's house or things like that. So many facilities are available, I can just order anything or I can get whatever I want. So there are always pluses and minuses if we are willing to have a positive attitude, particularly towards marriage and the other connected issues. Sirika also says, I think the drop dead deal breakers in marriage have undergone a drastic change. Earlier, hopeless addiction, physical violence, abuse in other forms, extreme mental health where the person was unwilling to seek medical support were the reasons for quitting. Yes, extreme cases. Now partners are preparing the eject button even before giving the issue really a good try. Very true, Sureka. As we keep discussing so many issues, so many couples whom you are also, you know, trying to patch up and trying to help, we are seeing this is happening. But as Sureka does, each one of us can put in our little mite of trying to see what we can do in terms of creating better harmony. If I am an elder person, I have had experiences of life, without sermonizing, without trying to, you know, press some issue down somebody's throat, I can help the person become more self-aware to take the right decisions. Veena says, but build stress and health issues begins. Stress, as you know, Veena, it comes from within. One person gets stressed out if there is financial problem. One person says it's okay, it doesn't matter. One person builds up stress when his marriage is not going well. The other person says, okay, I have other hobbies, I have other good relationships, I have children or I have so and so. So it doesn't matter, I am not going to get stressed out. So when you realize that something is not going well, and more so when it comes to a marriage relationship, please remember that there are other areas to keep yourself positive, to be optimistic, and to keep improving your quality of life, even if your marital relationship just does not improve at all. Venkatesh said, good afternoon, Ali. What if one partner wants to give up on marriage and leave while the other wants to hold on and resolve the issue in marriage? How do you deal with such a situation? What I normally do is that the person who wants to resolve and who wants to keep it up, I tell the person that since your partner is not willing to put in effort, are you willing to put in double the effort? Are you willing to put in gestures or actions without, at least in the beginning, get any reciprocation? Try it out and see. There are cases where it has worked. But after trying that out, if it doesn't work, it's as I was telling you earlier about any partnership. Supposing you went into partnership with somebody else and you started this business or whatever you are doing, and the other person says, no, for whatever reason, I don't want to be in partnership with you. What do you do normally? You just work out the best terms and conditions to part as friends and get away from them. The same thing can be done here. Sureka also says, because of better financial freedom, the woman is able to hold on to her respect and her individuality and not just live as half of a couple. That's a very positive thing that I've seen. Self-esteem of young girls has gone up. Their, you know, ability to take better decisions, to have control of their life. That is something which I'm watching and I'm very, very proud of it, to see how Indian girls who used to be so suppressed and, you know, relegated to the background, today are coming out on their own, and they can be extremely good role models to the others also. Kavita says, marriage is not only about two people. It's also about their families, where both have to make adjustments with the new family. Very true. And if you look at it that way, that as I told you, okay, I'm not having the best of relationship with my spouse. But maybe I have a father-in-law or mother-in-law or brother-in-law, you know, with whom I have a good relationship. So it's not an entire, you know, write-off. There are certain plus points, there are certain minus points, or there may be children or whatever it may be. Similarly, relationship also. I may have a spouse who's very bad to me, but is very good to the children. So if I love my children, I can also say that there is a plus point that my spouse loves my children and takes care of them. Think of that also. Okay, Dr. Pushpa. Yes, Pushpa. If the trust is broken by any of the partner and it is hurting and difficult to continue, still women tolerate and feel suffocated. What do you advise them? I advise them, like I told earlier also, that evaluate. See if there are other aspects of your life which are going good. So when you talk about this, you know, suffocation type of thing, get fresh air from somewhere else. You may have a very loving, doting sister. You may have a best friend. You may have your job or your colleagues or whatever it is. You may have a child who cares for you. Let the fresh air come from there. Don't keep harping on this one relationship which, if you have put in all the efforts and it is still not going well, but you don't want to separate also, accept it, continue with it. We are getting a lot of comments today. I think this is one topic which makes everybody sit up and think, right? Tessin says, Indian marriage is not all about pair. Many people influence the compatibility. You are absolutely right. We still live in a society which has got its plus points and minus points, where it is not just the man and woman who are involved. There are so many other people who are involved. And most importantly, children. I know of so many people who tolerate or accept a lot of things for the sake of the children or whoever it may be. So it's a holistic deal. And we need to look at the issue also holistically. Okay, Deepali says, now the very idea of how life must be led has changed. Hence, marriage is not the be-all and end-all like it was earlier. Nowadays, people think of settling down as less than ideal, and settling down has been gold standard for life in India for ages. Yeah, there are times, the other day I had a counselee and you know, she was saying that my parents are insisting that I should settle down. And I'm telling them I am very, very happily settled alone. I don't think I need a partner in my life and I have no regrets over it. There are young women who are taking such courageous decisions and living their life happily. Yavina says, but nowadays youngsters are happy after divorce. What's the use of staying together if there's no compatibility is their answer. That's what I tell them also, that if you have put in sufficient effort, unlike some people who are very impulsive, I gave you the example that, you know, the mother-in-law is creating problems, so I don't want to be with my spouse. Mother-in-law is not going to be a permanent part of your married life. So think about it. Can you tolerate? Can you accept for some time and start moving towards a better life, maybe 1 year, 5 years, 10 years from now? Or do you think that, no, I just cannot tolerate it, in which case, of course, the idea of separation and marriage is available. Just be aware of the impact it has on children. Children get affected more than anybody else. So as long as you are ensuring that the children's emotional needs are taken care of, we do take care of their financial and physical needs, but their emotional needs need to be taken care of. As long as you are doing that, you are an adult, you have the right to choose. Surekha says, today marriage endorses the concept that not everyone you lose is a loss. That's a very well put, Surekha. And so the willingness to let go of the relationship is more impulsive than ever before. That's what I was just saying a minute back, that never do anything, whether it is separation or in marriage or whatever it may be, never do anything impulsively. I know of people who select careers impulsively. I think that's a very, very sad thing to do. You should think over, you should plan. Same thing with, you know, if marriage is going back and you decide to separate, have you done it impulsively or out of anger or out of strong emotions? Or have you thought over sufficiently? Have you looked at both the sides of the coin? Have you evaluated what will happen post-separation or post-divorce? And then if you have taken decision, you will not regret it. So it also says, earlier marriage involved forgiving each other and promising never to give up on each other. Kabhi alvida na kehna. That used to be such a evergreen song. Nowadays, it means that we will be with each other till our needs are met. Value of commitment seems to be weakening. Yes, and we have to accept it. That's why I chose this topic today, that this is the changing face of marriage. Like you have a changing face of anything. Like my friend who had to give up his ancestral 2-acre land and get into a 2 BHK, you have to accept it. You can't afford today to live in a 2-acre land or house that you used to be living in earlier. Rushali says, thank you for your valuable inputs on the topic. Yes, Rushali, it's not just my own inputs. As you can see, so many of you are coming out with such wonderful inputs. It's a learning for me also. Okay. Indra says, good afternoon, Ali. The present generation don't accept with whatever we say. They feel it's old school of thought. Once it comes to social media, the same ideas they accept. At the same time, financial freedom is most dangerous as they look down upon a man who draws less salary, and it's vice versa also. Adjustment in life is totally forgotten. Most of them don't bother about relationships binding strong. This is where life skills comes in, Indra. Do I have the life skills to deal with difficult situations? Have I learned how to manage my emotions? Have I learned what motivates me? Have I learned how to handle my stress? Life skills is still not being taught at a rigorous level to children. I am very, very strong opinion that at least the young generation should be taught life skills much more than mathematics or chemistry or language or geography or whatever we are teaching children for years and years. So everything boils down to what Veena said just now, very difficult to convince youngsters. Yes, Veena, but one of my gurus had taught me there are a lot of things which are very difficult, but they are not impossible. Don't give up on difficult things unless they are impossible. It's difficult things which give us that spirit that, yes, I want to overcome this thing. So Dr. Pushpa is saying thank you. I also say thank you to all of you. And as we come to the end of this program, I will take your leave. We have already started off with our new batch of DCS, and I'm going for a class right now at 3:30. And Surekha says the relationship agenda is getting pushed to the back burner, and individual agendas are driving the relationship. Patience, maturity, and sacrifice are no longer words in the marriage vocabulary. That's a sad thing, but we keep making our efforts, we keep trying whatever best can be done from time to time. Let's all put in our little efforts here and there. Sometime we'll succeed, sometime we will not, because it is very difficult. But we should have that positive spirit, particularly in crucial issues like marriage. So the same way, there are so many other things which are equally important in life. So as I take leave, Anis is going to show you next week's topic so that you can, prepare your mind for it. It is called resilience, which in very simple words is, building the strength to face adversity, to face challenges, to overcome hurdles and setbacks. It's a simple word, resilience, but it has a lot of meaning. Maybe it's applicable to a lot of marriages also, where you have not very happy relationship, how you can build up your resilience. That is what we will be discussing next Saturday. That is the 13th of July at 2:00. Please join me and let's have a wonderful time. Thank you and bye-bye.